From the Fox 5 studios, this is the Red Zone Sports Show.
UNLV football leaves San Antonio winless. A tough fight from the true freshman quarterback Cam Friel, but Coach Arroyo is calling this loss uncharacteristic.
We know what it takes to win a football game in regards to what we've done here, as what we've done in the staff room during the past. We know what wins football games. We're right there in some of these games, but this one here, we took ourselves out of a lot of situations, and we still fought back. We're still driving to go tie the game late in the drive. But we put ourselves in a lot of bad situations, just making, not smart, just undisciplined, jumping off sides multiple times, just things like that we hadn't done. And so that was very uncharacteristic of our culture right now, and we're going to get it fixed.
And tonight we sit down with a rising star on the UNLV football team, junior wide receiver Steve Jenkins, who is building his highlight reel with play after play this season. What's his secret?
Just do my job. That's it. Nothing more, nothing less. Just do my job, whatever is asking me, execute that to the best of my ability, and that's all I can worry about. That's all I can focus on.
And practice number one is in the books for the new Runnin' Rebel squad. Brand new everything this year as Coach Kruger welcomes 9 transfers to UNLV.
We really just wanted to get guys in here that were competitive, represented UNLV the way it should be represented. I think one of our main goals was when anybody leaves the Thomas and Mac or watches us on the road, that they're proud. They're proud that these guys are representing UNLV, and they're playing hard and really just competing to win and competitive people.
New squad, who dis? But really, the Runnin' Rebels got 9 new guys on the team this season. It felt great to be back at practice this week, seeing all the new faces and some familiar faces too. Hey, I woke up this morning and felt how cold it was and said, yeah, the college basketball season is right around the corner, but it wasn't cold in Texas. It's still hot in Texas right now. We were in San Antonio this week, and we wore boots, ate too much barbecue, went to the Alamo Dome, and saw the UNLV football team battle against an undefeated UTSA team. A lot to unpack from Cam Friel's second start this season, the Hawaiian quarterback giving it everything he got last night. Coach Arroyo will be joining us soon to break down the game, so let's get to the highlights from the Alamo Dome.
The Roadrunners would hop on the board first. At the 9-yard line, Frank Harris over to Joshua Cephas, and UTSA takes a 7-0 lead. Rebels ain't happy about it. Next drive, true freshman quarterback Cam Friel slings it to Steve Jenkins, and he gone to the house. Game is tied up at 7. Danny Gutierrez would later kick a field goal as the Rebels take a 10-7 lead. 6:35 left in the second quarter, the freshman Cam Oliver almost picks off Harris in the end zone, and that would have been his second interception of the season. The Roadrunners would settle for 3 as we're tied up at 10. Later in the second, Friel throws his first interception of the night. UTSA would capitalize on the turnover with a handoff to Sincere McCormick into the end zone. The Roadrunners take a 17-10 lead at halftime. It was a tough second half for the Hawaiian, who kept battling out there, but would throw his second interception of the night. UTSA would once again capitalize on a Rebel turnover. Harris throws it deep to DeCorian Clark with the dive in the end zone. UTSA up 24-10. 6:46 left in the ball game. In goes Justin Rogers at the 9-yard line, rolls to his right, and finds Zyle Griffin in the end zone. That's Rogers' first touchdown pass of the season as UNLV trails 24-17. Rebels have a chance to tie up the game on 4th and 10, but Friel is sacked, and the Rebels leave San Antonio winless. Final score 24-17.
Hey, Coach, I'm still really full from all the barbecue I ate this weekend, but good to see you. Thanks for joining us. An opposite game from the Fresno State performance, were your starters being out this week, did that have an effect and play into the final score?
Yeah, I mean, I think anytime we're without some key ingredients for us and key guys in our program, some guys have to step up, and it's unfortunate, but there's still some good things to gleam out of it. But there's some characteristic things that popped up, turnovers and penalties, and that we need to hone up to this week, because those things are the difference of a game versus a good team in early stages of what we're doing.
What are you telling to your young guys, the next man up, the next guy who's coming in? What are you telling them last night?
Well, it's inevitable. I mean, without the depth of our program, these guys have, they all understand that the next guy could go in any time, and let alone the guy behind him. I mean, one guy goes down and all of a sudden you're in an emergency situation, you're number three. And when you're in the infant stage of the program we're in, that number three guy, he's had very limited reps, and he may be a guy that just got there or whatever it may be, and they got to be ready. So these things are rearing their head early, I should say, in the first half of our season. And so we're using them as examples for our guys that you got to be ready. And we talked about it preseason, you talk about it as you get prepared in camp, and now we're seeing it come to life, unfortunately. So we got to get guys as prepared as we can, as fast as we can.
Well, I feel like we saw a lot of growth from Cam Friel last night. What did you like about his play and his fight in San Antonio?
Well, you know, I think I like his composure, man. I like it. He's got his second time to get a start, and he completed 68% of his balls. He's playing catch a little bit better. Had some explosive plays. Definitely got some things he wants back. Turnovers were one. Hadn't done a lot of, and seeing through some of those coverages on third down and where to go with the ball in those situations versus those, you know, double clouds and those drop eight looks are really going to be more and more just experience than anything, and timing together. But I think overall, I mean, there's just a fight in him. There's a composure that we're all seeing and excited for him. He's got to stay healthy too. We got to keep him upright.
Well, Coach, I'm excited to see him and Steve Jenkins keep clicking as Friel builds more chemistry with the receivers. But we're sitting down with the junior, Steve Jenkins, and learning more about his story and how he grew up playing football with a few of his best friends on the team. Our one-on-one is coming up.
You're watching the Reb Zone Sports Show on Fox 5.
Well, it's clear the UNLV football team is banged up right now. They've got starters out left and right, so it's really the next man up. And the Rebels have great players on their team that can step up when their number's called. A perfect example of that is junior wide receiver Steve Jenkins, who just posted the first 100-yard receiving game for a Rebel since Kyle Williams in Hawaii last season. This week, I learned that he actually grew up playing ball with Kyle and Doug in LA. Here's more from our sit-down earlier this week. Are you impressed with the young guys on the team, like Doug and Cam, yeah, and their maturity?
Cam especially. Cam, he got here. I remember when he first got here, he was like kind of quiet a little bit. Really wasn't vocalizing a lot. And he just grown as far as his play and his maturity off the field too. It's probably like in the locker rooms type of stuff. It's big too, like just having one-on-one conversations with him about football and about stuff that we have to go over during the game and stuff like that. He's just grown a lot. Doug, he's always been, I've known Doug since I was in high school, so he's always been the same. He's grown a lot, but he's still the same Doug.
Gotten a little bit taller, yeah. It's funny, I mean, Kyle, you, Doug, you guys are all from LA. Did you know a lot of these guys?
Yeah, me and Kyle actually went to the same high school, so he used to be my quarterback, so he threw me a touchdown. And a lot of people don't know this, so he threw me a touchdown. We went against Doug's team and Sarah, and we beat them my senior year and my junior year.
In high school, were you always wide receiver, or did you play other positions?
I actually played quarterback. I played corner, safety, and receiver in high school, so I was a little bit of, I could do it all. I always say I'm the most athletic on the team. They don't believe me, though.
This season's kind of like the next man up, you know, a lot of injuries, whatever you guys are dealing with stuff. Is that how you see it? It's the next man up. You can go in anytime. You can make some big plays anytime.
Yeah, I feel like it starts in practice, so you got to be ready and locked in and taking mental reps in practice and stuff like that to even get to the game and make big plays. But it's definitely next man up. I feel like anybody can get in and make plays as long as they know what they're doing, know their assignment and things like that. We have great players on this team, so anybody and everybody can make something happen.
Fresno State was your guys' best game so far this season. Talk to me about practice last week and why practice last week was the best week for y'all.
It was just more ones-on-ones, meaning like the starting defense against the starting offense. We usually do scout and stuff like that, and you just don't get that same look, same speed, same competitiveness. So just getting that from our best players on defense just made us go harder on offense. So it was just more, the practice was just more, it just felt more alive. Like it felt like a game, kind of. So I think that's how practice should be all the time. It should always feel like that.
I've been talking to some of the guys about just being ready, being prepared, being ready to go in with different quarterbacks. What's that been like for you?
Me, I got a pretty good relationship with all the quarterbacks, so I could really care less about who's throwing me the ball as long as we're executing on offense. That's pretty much it, to be honest. I like all the quarterbacks. I like it. As long as O-line do their job, receivers do their job, running back do his job, then it's all going to mesh perfectly.
Talk to me about the past couple weeks. I know Kyle's been dealing with a hamstring, but talk to me about how does that change for you, or is your mindset always like, I'm going in anytime?
My mindset is basically I'm always going in. I know regardless, I'm always going to be on the field, whether it's at F, quarterback, receiver, wherever they want me is, I'm going to play. So I've never really looked at it as, oh, Kyle down, now it's my time. I'm probably Kyle's biggest fan, other than his people's, but I root for all my guys. So when he's back healthy, I'll be pushing for him. When he's down, I'll be pushing for the rest of my teammates. So that's how really it is for me. It's them before me.
Coach, he says he could be QB3, QB4, throw him anywhere. What versatility does he bring to your team?
Well, I like Steve at wide receiver, first of all. Done a good job. And he's definitely, you know, my hat's off to Steve. He's grown up a lot since he's been here, maturity-wise, and the way he works, his discipline and accountability. And a guy who got hurt last season and wasn't with us shoot at all. And I should say halfway, most of it. And then to come back and to be where he's at right now, the work the way he works, I'm excited for what he brings to our group. So he's great for that room. His maturity's growing, and it's good to see him flashing now as we get more and more.
What is he showing you in practice week by week that, you know, makes you be like, all right, let's get him out there?
Well, I mean, he's competing more. I mean, all these guys are learning how to really compete. He mentioned in that set, that the segment you had in regards to what we expect of our practices. This program's going to be built to where practices are going to be tougher than the game. You got to be able to line up against each other and give each other the appropriate looks with not having to go to one-on-one. But that's just the situation we're in right now, is to have to go good on good to get that, because we're just not deep. But eventually, guys understand that going to practice here and the way we compete in practice is second to none. And so that standard won't change. The expectation won't change. I think he's done a good job of elevating that standard each time we get a chance to get out there and practice.
Well, Coach, the bye week can't come at a more crucial time for you guys. Your team needs some time to heal. UNLV will host Utah State on October 16th after their bye week. We'll break down the Aggies with Coach Arroyo coming up next.
You're watching the Reb Zone Sports Show on Fox 5.
So the Rebels have a bye this week. Yes, it's coming at a much needed time to get these starters back out there as UNLV dives into conference play, hosting a 3-2 Utah State team on Saturday, October 16th. The Aggies lost to 13th ranked BYU 34-20 on Friday night, and also have a bye this week. They'll be heading into the bye week with two back-to-back losses to Boise State and BYU. Coach, I first want to start with the bye week. How does this week come at in your schedule? How crucial is it that it's right now for you guys?
When it comes in the middle of the season for us, it's always, I think, advantageous, because you get a chance to get a little bit of halftime, get yourself healthy. Hopefully that's not something you're always doing, but for us right now, that's going to help us. We're banged up pretty good, so we need some time to heal and time to look at exactly what we can do. We're going to assess it with a fine-tooth comb, be very intrinsic in regards to what we do, how we practice, what we're doing well. We're not of the mind here to just move forward and start game planning 2 weeks out on a bye week, when in fact you got a bunch of recruiting you got to get done, and then you got to really pull back the layers of exactly what you're doing schematically and collectively as a group, and figure out how you can do better going in the final second half of the season and last seven games.
I know you don't take the foot off the gas, but is this week more in the film room than the practice field?
Yeah, there's practice. We get practice, but we do a lot. There's a lot of film work, a lot of self scout. Then there's a lot of putting together prep plans for Utah State, and our coaches are on the road for the first time, really since we've been here. They'll be actually in on a campus potentially, which is pretty weird to say. But excited to hit the road this week and go see some guys.
You guys have two home games coming up. How crucial are they to win those home games at Allegiant Stadium at home?
They're all crucial. Home or away, doesn't matter. It's not who we're where. Our guys got to play winning football. We got to coach winning football. We got to continue to get better and not execute things in critical errors or that'll take away from those from those chances of victory. I mean, in the three games with a game of inches and 8 points and now 7 points, we're just right there at the edge, and our guys are starting to really see that it's just one or two plays away, and it can change the impact of the game versus really, really good teams. So we continue to pull back those layers and look at it. We'll still have practice for 2 days this week. There'll still be lifts. There'll still be academics. There's still a lot of stuff to get done.
Will you be gentle and cautious with Doug getting back out there?
Yeah, I mean, we're going to make sure that we're not going to put anybody in jeopardy that's injured. Our goal is to be healthy, so it won't be pushing anybody to the point of not being successful in that regard.
I'll wrap it up with Utah State. You guys didn't play them last year. Have you ever coached against Utah State?
I think so. I don't recall. That goes a long time. I haven't seen much of them yet. I saw a little bit of the game Friday night with BYU. They're a good football team with good coaches. They got to take a bunch of transfers that are there that have had to play. Another explosive and another good football team.
All right, Coach, it's the bye week, but you know you'll still see me around the building knocking on your doors with my camera. You can't get rid of me.
I'll be here.
All right, Coach, we'll see you next Sunday. Enjoy your bye week.
Thanks.
The Rebels are back. It's a brand new squad this season. New coaches, new players, new everything. We'll hear from Coach Kruger and the team after holding their first practice this week.
You're watching the Rev Zone Sports Show on Fox 5.
You want to get traded already?
We'll start you first.
I like defense.
We're going offense first, though. We got offense first right here. You want to go on defense? Okay. I thought so.
New squad, new coach, new season, it's go time. Practice number one is in the books this week as the Runnin' Rebels are welcoming a few familiar faces back and 9 transfers to UNLV, 4 from Power 5 schools. Will the Runnin' Rebels look like a Power 5 team this season?
Well, I mean, I've always felt, you know, UNLV is a Power 5 program. You know, just in terms of ability and resources. And I, but to that point, yeah, I think so. You know, obviously Royce and Vic coming from Oklahoma and Texas and Donovan, of course, coming from that Power 5 level, as you mentioned. But that was another thing we kind of looked for in the portal. It's kind of older, mature guys that have been through the wars. And the fact that they just happened to come from the Big 12 was just kind of just a happenstance. Big 10, ACC wouldn't really matter to us, but no, we love the group. I think they're high energy, high competitive level, and that's what we're going for.
And the Runnin' Rebels are excited to welcome back their leading scorer, Bryce Hamilton, who declared for the NBA draft this offseason and entered the NCAA transfer portal, but ultimately decided to come back to UNLV because of Coach Kruger.
We got a great relationship, you know, that's my guy. Even when he was an assistant coach, you know, we always had a close relationship. So, you know, coming back here would have been, it was a better transition, you know, come than any other school. And, you know, I'm happy that I made that decision.
And Hamilton is happy to be back with his guy, Marvin Coleman, who tells us how his recovery went this year after suffering a season-ending stress fracture in his right leg back in January.
It was long. I mean, it wasn't too bad. I got back on my feet within weeks, and then, you know, Brian, our athletic trainer, he was doing a lot to, you know, get me back moving, getting the blood flow out of there and stuff like that. So just getting the strength back in my legs was the main thing, and then getting back to the court, running up and down was just a next process.
Hey, good to see the Running Rebels back in action. Basketball season is right around the corner. UNLV will begin their 2021 schedule on Wednesday, November 10th, opening up to Gardner-Webb at home. The Rebels will actually play the entire month of November in Vegas. UNLV will take on Michigan in the Roman main event at T-Mobile Arena and also face Arizona or Wichita State. UNLV will also face UCLA and SMU before beginning conference play. That non-conference, y'all, is no joke. Conference play for the Runnin' Rebels will begin with SDSU at home on New Year's. That will be an exciting matchup to start the new year. And then we dive into it. 9 new faces on this team. Marvin and Bryce saying the talent on this team is next level, as the Rebels will debut 2 forwards from Texas, a forward from Oklahoma, and a guard from West Virginia. I know I said this at the beginning of the show, but I'm excited for this cooler weather, because when it gets colder in Las Vegas, that just means we're getting closer to basketball season. It's almost here. Pretty soon, I will be living at UNLV, going to football practice and running Rebels games. It's really the best time of the year. Maybe I should stop paying rent and start living at the Thomas and Mack. All right, UNLV has a bye week, but that doesn't mean we hit the pause button. I have a few fun features up my sleeve. I can't wait to show y'all. Stay tuned for next Sunday. I'll see you guys then. Have a great week, guys. Enjoy the bye week. We'll be here next weekend.